Hey, good morning, everyone. I'm Jim Belvo, Dean of the Foster School of Business. It's my pleasure to welcome you to our speaker series, Leaders to Legends. This is a bit different from our typical event in that it's being co-sponsored by our good friends in computer science and engineering. And representing that group is Ed Lazowska, who's the Bill and Melinda Gates Professor. Ed, would you stand and be recognized? Great having you here. Now on to our speaker, one of the great technology leaders in the U.S., Robbie Bach. Robbie's a graduate of UNC, where he was named Academic All-American in tennis. He then went on to work for Morgan Stanley, and after that he went to receive an MBA at Stanford. After his MBA, or shortly after, he joined Microsoft in 1988 and held a number of critically important positions. In particular, he was the marketing executive responsible for Office. And at the time he was responsible for Office, I believe WordPerfect and Lotus had about an 80% market share. And as you know today, Office is a money printer. I mean, it makes billions of dollars in revenue. He was ultimately appointed the chief Xbox officer in 1999 and oversaw the launch of Xbox and Xbox 360. When he retired in 2010, he was president of the Entertainment and Devices Division. Robbie now spends a great deal of time focused on civic engagement. He's the author of a 2015 book called Xbox Revisited, A Game Plan for Corporate and Civic Renewal. We have some copies on the tables there, and feel free to take those with you. He's also served as board chair of the Boys and Girls Club, and he's on the board of the U.S. Olympic Committee and the Bipartisan Policy Center in D.C. Please join me in a warm welcome for Robbie Bach. Thank you, Robbie.
Thank you. Thank you, Dean, for the introduction. This is a fun thing for me. I've lived in Seattle for almost 30 years, and I've never given a talk at the University of Washington. So today is my inaugural venture at the U, my local university. As is apropos, and thank you for the kind introduction, Dean. But as is apropos for the Bipartisan Policy Center part of my resume, I'm going to talk today about change. The premise of my talk today is that we, 15 years from now, 20 years from now, historians are going to look at the year 2016 and think of it like they think of the years 1865, 1932, 1968, pivot points in what's going on in American culture, American business, and American society. And so I want to talk about that context of change. I'll talk about it in a business context, and then maybe at the end we'll come back and talk about the social and personal aspects of that change. So, you know, in thinking outside the Xbox, how do we think about change? And the first thing you discover when you talk to people about change is it scares people. Change is frightening. Change is unpredictable. Change creates what we used to call in the tech industry fear, uncertainty, and doubt. The ever-popular FUD that you would try to disperse on some competitive product so that people were afraid of it. So change is a scary thing. My premise today, though, for you is that change is an opportunity. Change puts things on the table that were never there before and gives you the chance to take advantage of new opportunities like never before. And I want to talk about change in the context of three things. I want to talk about it in the context of strategy. I want to talk about it in the context of innovation. And I want to talk about it in the context of leadership. And hopefully I'll leave some time at the end. We can do some Q&A on that as well. So let's start with strategy. And for me, that starts with the Xbox. If you take away one of the copies here of Xbox Revisited, you'll read a little bit of this story. But strategy, to me, the number one lesson I learned on Xbox was that strategy matters. Okay, I'm a Stanford MBA. You'd think I would know that beforehand. Apparently, they didn't teach that very well at the university down there. But I learned that on Xbox. And so let's talk about strategy in the context of the Xbox story. Xbox started in 1999. It was truly the craziest business plan you could possibly imagine. The premise was that Microsoft needed to be in the living room to compete with Sony, who was building something called the PlayStation 2, which they dubbed a computer for the living room. That scared all of us in Redmond a bit, and we decided we needed a competitive product. And so our charge was to build the greatest, fastest, best video game console and do it in 18 months. Now, understand that in the hardware space, anybody here from the engineering school knows that in the hardware space, 18 months isn't 18 months. 18 months is actually about 11 months, because you need about the last 6 or 7 months to actually test, manufacture, and figure out how the product's going to work. So, and we had 20 people. So start with 20 people, 18 months, 11 months for the hardware team, go. That was the challenge. And the business plan said, you know, we understand this is going to be hard. We think you can lose somewhere between $1.8 and $2 billion. That's a lot of money. Big investment. So the team gets started. I will tell you that 18 months was the worst 18 months of my life. If you think of it this way, if your strategy is the following, ship by this date and make sure the explosions look great, that was the strategy. And everything else didn't matter. And so what happened is every day I came into work, I looked around and I said, oh, there's a fire burning in operations. I better go put that fire out. And the next day I'd come in and say, the fire is still burning in operations, but there's also one in marketing. I need to put both of those fires out. And that's the way 18 months went. And about 14 months into that, I resigned from Microsoft. I literally at 3 in the morning wrote a letter to my boss in email, sent it to him. Letter's actually in the book. I found it in my email repository someplace. I was so frustrated with what was going on, and I knew the project was off the rails. And I just said, this is too hard, I can't do it. And in hindsight, the reason it was too hard is because we didn't have strategy. Now, that product did somehow manage to ship. Miraculously, it shipped within 7 days of its original launch date. And through the grace of God and some other things that happened that were fortuitous, the product, you could say, was successful. If you remember the original Xbox, it was sort of that black square thing that looked like a radiator from the 1930s. But people bought it. And we had, I don't know, in the United States, let's say 25% market share. In most of Europe, 20-25% market share, about the same as Nintendo's GameCube. So we felt pretty good about that. You might call that a success. But here's the problem. The problem was the business itself was a disaster. Remember that $1.8 to $2 billion that we said we thought was so much? In 4 years, not five, in 4 years, we lost, depending on who does the accounting and how you do the internal cost allocations, somewhere between $5 and $7 billion. So this has gone from an expensive investment to a financial catastrophe. And in most companies in the world, probably in every other company in the world, as the CEO responsible for that, I would have been fired. Well, almost for sure. And probably the rest of Xbox would have been canceled. But that wasn't the way Microsoft thought about it. Microsoft said, hey, this is important for us. We've got to be successful. These teams learned a lot. They're smart people. They'll figure it out. Go. Start working on the second version of the product. So that first version was a strategic sort of disaster. A market beachhead was built, and financially it was a mess. So immediately after we ship, this is probably 3 weeks after we ship, the silicon engineers, God bless them, come to our executive team meeting and they say, hey, we need to know what you want us to build for the next version of Xbox. And we've barely figured out that we've shipped the first version of Xbox, but they need about 5 years of lead time, so we have work we've got to do. So the team goes off. At Microsoft, when you have a real hard problem, what you do is you have a retreat. That's the natural reaction to difficult problems. You take all the management team. We went to Salish Lodge. There's a little room up above the bar that I will always hold near and dear to my heart. And we spent 3 days arguing about the future of Xbox. And we concluded that our problem was a strategy problem. And we developed a strategy process, which I talk about at great length in the book, that we used to fix Xbox. And the basic idea is quite simple. The basic idea is you have to be able to tell the team, as a leader, in 3 pages, and no more than 3 pages, the following 3 things. First, what's your purpose? The second is, what are the principles under which you're going to operate? And the third, what are the priorities that matter? This is completely obvious. And if you ask most business leaders, certainly if you ask civic leaders, they don't do this work. You don't step back and say, okay, in three PowerPoint slides, I only need three PowerPoint slides, one for purpose, one for principles, one for priorities. I can describe the right strategy for a business, or the strategy that I'm going to pursue. So what is purpose? Purpose is a single one-sentence North Star statement. It is the statement that says, this is what we absolutely are going to do. And I'll give you two good examples, well, actually three. First is from Microsoft. In 1975, as the PC was sort of being created for the first time, and I only say sort of because it wasn't really much of a machine, Bill Gates and Paul Allen said, we're going to put a computer on every desk and in every home running Microsoft software. That's a purpose statement. Visionary, clear, and focused. And it ran Microsoft for 25 years. And in fact, the company only got into trouble when we'd outlived the purpose statement and when people felt like we'd achieved it and they didn't know what to do next. So, first example. Second example, I work with a company called Sonos. Do people know who Sonos is? I hope some people nod their heads. Really cool Wi-Fi speaker system company. And their purpose statement, if you asked a Sonos employee, they'd say, oh, it's to put all the world's music in every room in the house. Really simple. I'm going to take all the world's music, think about what that means, and put it in every room in your house. And every engineer at Sonos says, oh, that has implications for what I'm trying to do. The marketing team says, oh, that gives me direction. The people who are trying to sell the product know what they're selling. So purpose is really important. And it's not just big companies. I happen to be the co-owner of a gluten-free pasta company in Kent called Menini's. So if you want great, fresh, gluten-free pasta, go to Whole Foods and buy Menini's. And Menini's purpose statement is great-tasting food for a healthy lifestyle. And gluten-free food generally doesn't taste good. I think I can do a taste test with you, and you won't know which product was gluten-free and which one wasn't. So that's the premise and purpose of what we do every day at Menini's. So purpose, super important. Second, principles. Principles are how you operate. What are you going to do every day in working together? One of the challenges of the original Xbox is that we had about six cultures in that team, and we didn't know how to work together. And there were no operating guidelines for how to get things done together. So you have to be able to write down 4 to 5 statements. And you don't get more than 5 because then you're not a very principled person. So 4 to 5 statements that define your principles for operation. I'll give you the one quick example from Xbox. Microsoft liked this thing where you had control of your own P&L. So each of my groups within the Xbox team had their own P&L. That meant that nobody optimized for the Xbox P&L, which meant we lost $5 to $7 billion. And so one of our principles for the second version of the product was, there is one P&L in the group, Robbie manages it, we will make sure that one works. The rest of you no longer have a P&L, we'll give you an expense budget, and if you don't like that, sorry, but that's the way it's got to work. And some people said they didn't like that and left. And that was actually okay. So principles are about defining how you work together, and about how a team comes together and how decisions get made. And it is the principles phase that people skip the most quickly. And it's the one you will regret skipping later on. Because you can't really have an argument about a topic if you haven't first had the discussion about the principles that are important to the topic. And so forcing people to take the time to think about principles and why they are important is a huge step in the strategy process. Third part is priorities. I manage people for almost 20 years at Microsoft, and every 6 months, we would have people come in and say, tell me your priorities for the next 6 months. This is a standard review process. And people would give a list of, I'd say, on average, 7 to 8 things they were going to get done. And what I learned over time is that nobody gets 7 to 8 things. You just don't. And at the end of the 6 months, they'd come back and say, hey, I got these 5 things done. The problem was I didn't know which 5 they were. Because in the list of 7 or 8, I had no way of knowing which was the most important. And you might have gotten numbers 3 through 8 done, but if you didn't do priority 1 and 2, that's a failure. So prioritization is not only about deciding what's important to you, but it's about deciding what's not important to you. You only get five priorities. And if you get the five things done that you set out in your strategy plan to get done, I promise you the likelihood of success goes up dramatically. And the fact that you did not do number six will not hamper you. And in fact, what you'll find is part of number six gets done anyway. And so if you can take a business, a strategy, and say, I can define purpose, I can establish principles, I can select what is and is not important in my priorities, you have a chance to win. Now, the strategy might be wrong. You may pick the wrong North Star. Your priorities might not be the right ones. So you can still fail. But you have the opportunity. You've given yourself the platform for success. Now, in the case of Xbox, we wrote that three-page document. First time we'd ever done it. It's not a Microsoft standard practice, something we created out of thin air. We wrote that document, we spread it around the team, and we used it. And that second version of the product, Xbox 360, had, I don't know, on a global basis, about 45% market share, not 25% market share. They've sold to date something north of 80 million Xboxes compared to 22, Xbox 360s compared to 22 for the first version of the product. And it made the company billions of dollars and built an asset that today by itself is worth billions of dollars as a standalone asset. And I'm not going to tell you that strategy was the only thing that got us there. Sony made some colossal mistakes that helped, and there were some other things in the market that helped us. But strategy is essential. It's the building block and the foundation of success. And it's easy to think you have a good idea and skip past the strategy. Start with purpose. Figure out your principles. Decide your priorities. Then you can go forward and actually execute and make things happen. So that's my first quick topic on strategy. Now, strategy isn't sufficient. You actually need something. You need something more than strategy. You need ideas. You need a way to do things differently. If you are going to structure and manage change, if you are going to take the change that's happening in the marketplace and bend it to your will, you have to have ideas to make that happen. And so this is where I talk about innovation. I just finished reading a book, which I highly recommend. It's called The Last Days of Night. It's a book by Graham Moore. It's also the guy who wrote the screenplay for The Imitation Game. And in The Last Days of Night, it's historical fiction. So it's historically accurate with some fiction thrown in and some timelines condensed. But it's the story of the fight between Thomas Edison and George Westinghouse on the future of electricity in the United States. And the story itself is fabulous. It's incredibly well written. I read it straight through. It's awesome. And there's some interesting history there that I didn't know. I finally discovered where Tesla came from, so I'm not an engineer, so that was an interesting thing for me to understand how that came about. But the better part of it was understanding how Tesla, Westinghouse, and Edison thought about innovation. And all three of them thought about innovation in completely different ways. So I want to talk about innovation not as, oh, I'm going to go sit in the garage and hope an idea pops in my head. I want to talk about innovation as a process, as a way of doing things. So the way I think about innovation is this little acronym I use called BXT. And so BXT stands for business, experience, and technology. And each of those are areas where we can drive innovation. And I think typically we think of innovation as being something that happens in the engineering department. I'm going to tell you that I think it's something that happens in the engineering department, the business department, human resources, and a bunch of other places inside a company. So let's talk about the B in BXT. B stands for business. When I ask people, I was the somewhat fortunate but mostly unfortunate leader of another project at Microsoft called the Zune. And so I get asked a lot of questions about music and how Apple innovated in the music space. And with most groups when I talk, I say, you know, so what did Apple do to innovate? And most people's response is, oh, they did iTunes. Or they did the iPod. Both of which are products. Both of which are technical things. And that's not how they innovated at all. They did some nice innovation there for sure. But that wasn't the big idea. The big idea was a business idea. Apple recognized that the problem in the music space was that people were stealing songs. And that the album was dead. Nobody wanted to pay $15 for something they could get when they only wanted one song. So I'm going to pay $15 for one song, or I can steal it for free. People stole it for free. Hence was birthed the 99-cent song. And when Apple convinced the labels to allow the 99-cent song, they took control of the music industry. And you can draw almost a linear line between the 99-cent song and the iPod's success and the iTouch's success and the iPhone's success and Apple being the largest market cap company in the world. And so from one simple business idea comes, you know, 15 years of innovation. And so business ideas are powerful, and they can change the way entire industries are structured. Second thing, I want to talk about experience. Now, you have to recognize this BXT framework was from the Xbox team, so we had to have an X in the acronym. I do know that experience begins with an E, but we had to have an X, so we decided that this would begin with an X. And experience to me, I describe it as the following. It's the magic and smile that comes to your face when you use a product or when you get a service. Now, this is hard to remember, but remember what it was like the first time you picked up or saw an iPhone or when Steve Jobs was doing his first demonstration when they announced the iPhone, and he swiped on the screen and it moved. You would have thought there'd been an earthquake every place in the world. People went, oh. And you would just see people doing this, not because it was doing anything, but because it just felt good. It was cool. The screen responded to what I did. That's a magical experience. Let me give you a better example. People give credit to Uber for a lot of innovation. And if you ask somebody at Uber what they are, they will say, we are a ride-sharing service. I would say, well, that's a very good politically correct legal distinction, but actually not really what Uber is. What Uber is a taxi cab company. And what Uber did is they reinvented the taxi cab experience. Before Uber, you were in New York in November, I've done this so I know, and you want a taxi cab at 4:30 to go to the airport, and it's sleeting outside. So you stand on the corner, raise your hand, there are no cabs, the one that comes by turn off their lights and then splash you and get your shoes wet. That's what the taxi cab, and by the way, if you called the taxi cab company, they automatically would tell you there'd be a cab there in 20 minutes. That didn't matter whether they knew there was a cab or not, they just said 20 minutes. And 20 minutes could be 20 minutes, it could be 2 hours, you had no way of knowing. Uber changed all of that. Now they used some technology and some business principles to do that, but the fundamental insight into what made Uber successful was the experience itself. And that experience was magical. It put a smile on people's faces. And it created a verb. That's the epitome of success. When you can create a verb, that is the epitome of success. B, X. And finally, there is T. And to anybody who was here from the engineering department, T does matter. It's important. It's critical. I ran a business. Anybody here remember the product called Encarta? Encarta was the coolest thing ever. It's an amazing encyclopedia. It had all of World Book and all of Britannica in it, all incredibly well-researched, incredibly sourced, maps, interactive videos. It sang, it danced. It was incredible. And then the guys at Google came out with a search algorithm that was really a technical piece of work. The experience itself wasn't anything special, but it was really an amazing technical piece of work that took other people 10 years to sort of catch up to. And in the space of a year, Encarta was gone. Vanished, buried by the internet. Because a piece of code was written that enabled people to search the internet in a way that they'd never been able to search it before. BXT. And the best companies, the best products, the best outcomes innovate in all three. Interestingly, in each of the examples I gave, Apple, Uber, and Google, I can actually tell you how each of them innovated in B, in X, and in T. And they each had sort of a special space where they were special in what they did, but they did all three. And that is the magic of innovation, is figuring out you can take a core idea in one of those areas, match it to some interesting things in other areas, and build something really great. So that's my second thing, strategy and innovation. Now, those two alone don't actually even get you over the finish line, really. Because as I discovered in the Xbox business, success is all about leadership. And beyond the strategy changes we made between the first and second version of Xbox, I led the second version in a completely different way. and I was fortunate along the way to have some experiences that helped me do that and some people who guided me. I always, when I went into the first version of Xbox, I said, gosh, I'm a good leader. I know how to do this. And I discovered I was a thoroughly mediocre leader and really didn't know how to do it. And the results showed. And we went to do Xbox 360, I had to change. I went and took a 10-week sabbatical. My wife and I went and got some professional help in leadership and family management coaching. And I changed both my approach to my life and my approach to business and my approach to leading a team. And so for me, leadership is a special thing. Some people have some natural capabilities, but everybody can do it in their own way. And so I want to talk a little bit about some things that I think are principles of leadership that will help you take what is a good strategy and an innovative idea and actually make it successful. So the first thing in leadership is I think of it like the Avengers. And if you think about the Avengers, each of the Avengers themselves has a superpower. So Iron Man is really smart. The Hulk is, you know, really big. Black Widow is really stealthy and secretive. Thor, I don't know, the stupid hammer just does something magical whenever he wants it to. You never quite know where it comes from. But he has a superpower too. They all have superpowers. And the truth is, every person in this room has superpowers. You have things that you are uniquely good at. And one of the secrets of leadership is figuring out and being self-aware enough to understand what it is you are uniquely good at. Now, the interesting thing about the Avengers is that individually they were all pretty good, but it's collectively when they are great. Because the flip side of having superpowers is you all have kryptonite as well. And each of us as leaders has things we are not good at. And so the challenge as a leadership, as a leader, is to understand where you have that superpower and then surround yourself with people who complete you as a leader. And you build, it's a hackneyed phrase, but you build a leadership team. And you build a group of people that collectively form a complete leadership idea. Doris Kearns Goodwin wrote a book not 3 or 4 years ago, which you may have read, called Team of Rivals. And if you haven't read it, it's a long read. It's like 900 pages, but it's fascinating. And it is the story of Abraham Lincoln. And if you remember the movie Lincoln that came out 3 or 4 years ago, that is 3 pages in the book Team of Rivals, and only 3 pages. And the rest of the book tells the story of Lincoln's rise to power and what he did as president during the Civil War. And the amazing thing is he fought to get the Republican nomination with 3 other guys who were probably more qualified than he was. And he managed to figure out how to win the nomination. But the interesting thing to me is, what did he do right away? The first thing he did was ask all 3 of them to join his cabinet. And he looked at those 3 people and said, they have talents I do not have. One of them was a guy who he wanted to be Secretary of State. He needed somebody to run finance. Turns out if you're going to have a war, you got to spend a lot of money. He needed somebody who could keep the border states in the Union. And he thought about his leadership not as, I'm Abraham Lincoln, the great leader. He thought of it as, I can do a certain set of things. I need to surround myself with people who can do things I can't do, either because I don't have the skills or the knowledge to do it. And that team of rivals, his cabinet was a nightmare because they were a team of rivals. And yet, Lincoln's great leadership skill, as I think he recognized, was the ability to keep people together and the ability to make choices, the ability to know when to compromise and when not to. And he pushed our country through the most difficult period in its history. That, to me, is the epitome of this concept of how you find your superpower and then surround yourself with other people. Leadership principle number one. Second, I like history. I love World War II history. My dad fought in World War II. And I've spent a little bit of time, not as much as I'd like probably, understanding Dwight Eisenhower and George Patton. And you can't imagine, if you watch the movie Patton, you see this. You can't imagine 2 important generals in the U.S. Army in Europe more different than Dwight Eisenhower and George Patton. Dwight Eisenhower was probably closer to a diplomat than he was a general. He was put in charge of the Allied forces because people thought he could keep the Allies together, and he could make decisions between the British and the Americans and the Canadians and the Australians and the French, and somehow managed to keep that coalition working together. George Patton was mostly kind of a jerk, a bit of a bulldog, and somebody who just wanted to win, and had a pretty oversized ego. Completely different characters, and both great leaders. And part of the reason they were both great leaders is they got something from the people who worked for them that is really challenging to find and incredibly important to get, and that's respect. I promise you that if you ask somebody who fought in World War II at the time, who somehow was under the command of Eisenhower or Patton, not many would have said they liked either one of them. Soldiers thought Eisenhower was a do-nothing, and they thought Patton was a jerk. So that's not actually a great recommendation for either one of them. But if you ask them whether they respected them, they would say absolutely. When I see employees from Microsoft, people who used to work for me, sometimes I remember them, sometimes I don't, frankly. But they come up and we chat. I'll be at the airport, we'll chat, and they'll give me the highest compliment they can give me. They say, look, I don't always know whether we made the right decisions or did the right things, but I respected the way you worked with us. That, to me, is the highest form of compliment you can give a leader. And so as a leader, thinking about how you build respect in your team. So you build your leadership team, that Avengers group of people. But then you also have to have the respect of the people who you have to remember, they're actually going to do the work, you're not. And so figuring out how to build that respect is powerful. The final thing in leadership is something I again learned at Stanford and didn't realize it and sort of ignored it. And that is the power of culture. And in some ways, if I was starting a company today, actually I am, because Menini's has all of 20 employees, culture is everything. It's the beginning and the end of a company. And it's the beginning and the end of how a leader actually makes things change and makes things great. And for me, culture is not a slogan. It's not five things you put up on the wall. It's not a campaign. Culture is what you do every single day to tell people how to work, how to act, and how the company operates. And people are unconsciously brilliant at understanding culture. They see signals in what happens every day, and they put them into context, and they create a cultural story around them, and they do it without even thinking about it. And as a leader, if you're not careful, you will create that culture without even thinking about it. And suddenly, a year and a half later, you'll say, oh, how did I get here? And why is the team acting that way? And the reason they're acting that way is because you and the rest of your leaders modeled that behavior. Why was the first version of Xbox dysfunctional as a team? Because the leadership team was dysfunctional as a team. We fought with each other. People thought that was okay, so the whole team fought with itself. How do you change that culture for the positive way? One of the most powerful tools I've learned, actually mostly post-Microsoft, but sort of towards the end of my Microsoft career, is the ability for a leader, not only in their actions every day, but in the stories they tell, in the things they share about themselves, to influence how people think about the organization, the culture, and where things are going. And I'm going to do a little bit of a quick role play for you to try to bring that point home. At one point in my time in the entertainment devices division, we were trying to get behind a strategy we called three screens and a cloud, which turned out to be really a good strategy that we never quite got finished, but okay. The idea was PC screen, mobile phone screen, TV screen, cloud service, deliver content to all three. It's actually the way the world works today. But this was before that was happening. And the team couldn't get their heads wrapped around it. They couldn't figure out how we were going to win. They couldn't figure out how to get there and how to come together. So I'll tell the story sort of in character. We had a group, about this number of people, get together, the leaders across the division, and I told them, I'm going to tell you a little story about myself and tell you why this we're going to be successful with the strategy. So here's my story. So when I was 13, I was a, I don't know, 5 or 6 sport athlete, was a nationally ranked tennis player, played football, played basketball, loved sports. Unfortunately, in that year, I also grew 8 inches. This is the 70s. It's the era of plaid bell bottoms. So I'm walking around with the plaid bell-bottom high-water pants because I'm growing too fast and I'm growing out of my clothes. It was an ugly look. But in addition to it being an ugly look, it actually caused a problem for me physically. Two of the vertebrae in my back didn't grow at the same pace. And I ended up with a condition called kyphosis. Do people know what scoliosis is? Now, scoliosis is the more common form of the disease. It's a sideways curvature of the spine. I had kyphosis, which is a forward curvature in the spine. I had a 40-degree forward curve in my spine, which basically means I walked around like this all day. And untreated, you know, for a long period of time, you start to have organs get crushed. It's a really bad thing. So I went to, you know, as luck would have it, I lived in Milwaukee, Wisconsin. The foremost doctor for treating scoliosis and kyphosis was in Milwaukee. It's a guy named Walter Blount. He was over 70 years old, had Parkinson's disease, and I was the last patient he admitted. And he treated me with something called the Milwaukee brace, which actually is in the Smithsonian. It's a leather girdle that goes around your waist. It's a metal bar in front. It's two metal bars in the back and a metal ring around your neck. And I wore that between 20 and 24 hours a day for the next 5 years. So that brought some change in my life. Now, having said that, with the strength of my mom and some help from others, I learned how to play tennis in the brace. I went on to be a national-ranked tennis player in the brace. And as Dean said, I was an academic All-American in tennis at the University of North Carolina. Now, my reason for telling you that story isn't because I want you to feel sorry for me. Instead, what I want you to understand is that I hate losing. Nothing is going to get in my way. And if I was in the team context, nothing is going to get in the way of this team being successful if I have anything to say about it. Now, when you step back from the story, it does two things for the team from a leadership perspective. One, it makes me completely human to the people I work with. And the second thing it does is it tells them something that's deep in my core that I hold dear and that I'm going to fight for. And something that is the way we are going to act and think and work as a group. And you do it in a way that it's not a slogan. It's people walking away saying, okay, well now I got to think about that a little differently. If he can do that, we can do anything. And that is the point of storytelling. It's incredibly powerful. It's the reason books, I've talked about three books during my talk today. That's the reason. Stories are powerful. And they change the way people think. And so, if you think about leadership, and you think about the Avengers and building that complete team, and you think about earning respect, and you think about building culture, you now have a full story. You have a strategy to drive you, innovative ideas to fulfill things, and a leadership approach and culture that can make it happen. That, to me, builds an opportunity for success. That, to me, is what can take really complicated problems and drill them down into simple things that can be solved. And I've talked about everything I said today in the context of business. The dean mentioned that I'm involved in civic organizations like Boys and Girls Club, the U.S. Olympic Committee, and the Bipartisan Policy Center. I use all of this work in that every day. Imagine how things would work if our government operated from a sense of strategy that focused on innovative ideas and then had an appropriate culture of leadership. I do a lot of this work in nonprofits. They are incredibly passionate about what they do and not as disciplined about strategy, innovative thinking, and leadership change as they should be. And when you get them powered by that, they can change the world. And so my premise to you today is that the things we've talked about certainly are about business and your business career. This is a business school after all. But they're also about your personal life. And they're also about the things you do outside your work. And they create principles and opportunities to really do great things. And if there's one thing you take away from your time at the U, it should be, I learned a bunch. I've got skills. There's things I can go do. But it should also be I can make a difference. Not just in my business life, but in what I do in my community. So, with that, I'm going to turn it over to you guys for questions. We can talk about Tar Heel tennis or basketball if you would like. We can talk about Xbox and Halo. We can talk about really whatever you'd like. But hopefully I've given you some meat to chew on. So who has questions?
First of all, yeah, thanks, Robbie. That's terrific. Questions?
Yeah.
Ed.
So this is a sweeping talk, and I have, unfortunately, a narrow question.
Sure.
Mm. Overcome. So, for instance, a company that had a Microsoft Home effort and it had Office as a cash cow.
Yep. And most importantly, had Windows.
Right. Here's the thing that comes to mind. I remember under NDA, very early days of the Xbox, seeing a presentation in which this thing was going to be successful despite not having top tier graphics because it was going to run Office in the living room.
Well, I think there are two things I would highlight. The first is I played a unique, I suppose, role in running the Xbox business. First of all, you should understand one thing. I don't play video games. I don't like video games. Never have, probably never will. I love the video game business, but I don't play video games. Second thing is I'm not at all technical. I've written no code in my life. I've taken one computer science class in 1983 using punch cards, and the translation machine between the mini computer and the local PC broke, and we never finished the class. So I'm neither of those things. So part of my role at Microsoft was I knew everybody inside the company. And so my job became, over time, to fight interference for the rest of the team. And my job was to tell them to go do what they knew was right, and I would deal with other things. So when the corporate marketing and PR team came and said, oh, we want to select your ad agency for you, I said no. And, oh, we have the PR agency for you. I said, no, that's actually the wrong agency. We'll take care of that. And my job was to both have the organizational position and the communication skills to make people feel okay about that. So that's one thing. And so you really had to have somebody who was building a little bit of a firewall around the group. Second thing is you have to have the hard conversation. And you have to have it with Bill and Steve. And so there's an epic meeting, which I talk about in the book, called the Valentine's Day Massacre. And the Valentine's Day Massacre took place about 6 weeks after they'd approved Xbox. And they suddenly realized we'd approved something that would never run Office. In fact, it wasn't going to run any of Windows. And in fact, it was going to be a dedicated single processing game machine. And that's what it was going to do. And they suddenly realized that and said, oh, well, that's bad. And so Bill called the meeting, and it's 4:30 on a Valentine's Day. He comes in typical Bill fashion, and love the passion, but he comes in about 15 minutes late, pounds the table, and asks me why I'm trying to destroy Windows. I don't have anything to do with Windows. We had a three-hour argument about the future of Xbox, 6 weeks after it had been approved. And the argument essentially came down to, are you going to let us build a video game console the way we want to build it, that's independent of the way Microsoft does things, or are you going to force us to try to use Windows to create a PC in the living room? We, by the way, think that latter strategy will fail, and if you want to do that, you should get a different team. And after 2 hours, that's what I said. I said, look, if you don't want us to do Xbox this way, we'll just stop. It's okay. We all had jobs at Microsoft before. We'll go back. There's plenty of things to do. And then the final hour was arguing about what would happen if we didn't do Xbox in the living room. And to their credit, at the end of that, Bill and Steve said, okay. Well, actually, this is a classic moment. Steve Ballmer looks to Rick Belluzzo, who was my boss, and Rick, God bless him, didn't know very much about what we were doing on Xbox, but I worked for him. So Steve looked at him and said, Rick, do you think these guys can get this done? And Rick, without missing a beat, said, absolutely. Now, he had no clue. But he said, absolutely they can get this done. And Steve said, to his great enduring credit, okay, we're done. We won't argue about this ever again. You will have our support. And he and Bill were the hardest core supporters of Xbox for the next 5 years. Wow. And made a huge difference in what happened in the business. And so those are the kinds of things you have to think about when you're trying to build something entrepreneurial inside a big company. Other questions? Yeah.
Can you talk about an example where you brought strategy and innovation to one of your civic engagement
outlets? Sure. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, sorry, for folks in the back. An example where I brought strategy and innovation to one of my nonprofit work. I do a lot of work with the U.S. Olympic Committee. I'm on the board there. And the Olympic movement is a very complicated movement. There's the U.S. Olympic Committee Board. It's about 15 people. They are responsible, legally, by act of Congress, to run the Olympic movement in the United States. But there are 49 independently run national governing bodies of each sport as well. And they're actually the ones who train the athletes and who select the athletes to go to the Olympics. And so we supply money to them to train the athletes, and they raise some of their own money. And we had a long, hard problem about how do we get more people on the podium? And how do we get more specific about what we're doing? And so there was a new CEO at the U.S. Olympic Committee who joined a little bit before I did. He asked me to help him on the strategy process for building the next generation strategy for the business. And we used exactly the 3P framework that I talked about here today and that I talk about in my book. We made word changes in the mission statement. I think we changed 4 words in the mission statement. But we took it from being the mission of the group to being supporting all sports in the U.S. to effectively putting more athletes on the podium. So that was a change in the purpose statement. And then in principles, we wrote down 5 things that we stood for. And one of those was working with the IOC. We had a horrible relationship with the IOC. Another of them was working with the athletes. Our relationship with the athletes wasn't much better. And another was working with the national governing bodies, where our relationship also wasn't all that good. And suddenly, those are principles for the organization. People say, okay, they're important. We've got to go do that. And finally, we established, you know, a really crisp set of priorities for people to focus on. When I started there, the scorecard had 149 items on it. We're now down to less than 15. And that reflects the strategic focus of the organization. What happened because of the change of purpose is some sports stopped getting funding. It caused a ruckus in the movement. But if you're in modern pentathlon, we don't have the coaches, the athletes, the governance structure in that national governing body to ever win a medal. And by the way, it's only 1 medal, or 2 medals, because it's team sport. And so modern pentathlon doesn't get a lot of money today. But if you're in swimming or diving or track and field or places where we do have the opportunities to win medal, you do. And if you're in sports that where we've not been successful but where we see opportunities, we fund that as well. And that was all based literally on 3 or 4 words changed in a purpose statement. And what the leadership team did is they went and said to all the national governing bodies, like it, don't like it, let's have the argument, but this is how we think about things. And this is what the board has approved. And there was a little bit of a kerfuffle, but people suddenly said, I get it. I know the rules. I understand how the game is going to be played. Let's go. And you saw the results in Rio. Set a record for medals won. In the end, that's all obviously all about the athletes. But there's power in it, and it can change things. Yeah. Yeah, it's actually really an important point. You can sit and write your 3P framework, and certainly you're thinking about the competition when you write it, but it's easy to lose sight of it and forget about it. And so in the Xbox case, we got half of it right on the competitive front. So about 2/3 of the way through the development of Xbox 360, we hired a consultant to do a game theory for us. And they literally developed a 2-day offsite process where we were going to play out the next generation of the video game console as a game. And each of us played roles. There were people who played the role of Nintendo and Sony and the third-party publishers and the press and Microsoft, etc. And at the end of 2 days, we said, oh my gosh, we're going to lose. And we're going to lose because our machine's not powerful enough. And because we're not spending enough time with our third-party publishers. And Sony's going to kill us. And so what did we do? Well, we doubled the memory in the machine, so the machine got more powerful. That was expensive and hard from an engineering perspective, but we did it very late in the process. And we increased our allocation of resources to third-party publishers, which led to Call of Duty being essentially an exclusive on Xbox 360, which made Xbox 360 the console it is today. Now, I said we only got it half right, because in that strategy process, we sort of ignored Nintendo, because we didn't think they had the chops to compete. And in fact, they came out with the Wii, and for the first 2 years of that generation, they kicked our butt. Now, we eventually caught up with them, but we were blindsided by that. And we didn't think carefully enough about disruptive technology that could come into play. And they disrupted everybody with the wand, And that was a real challenge for us. So you're absolutely right that you have to think about competition as you're developing the strategy. And just getting the strategy right isn't a guarantee to success. It's just a foundation piece. You still got to do the rest of the work. other questions?
I've got a question.
Yeah.
So when you started off, you had a team of, I believe, about 20 people, as
right.
you said. But probably when you launched, you had a couple of thousand.
That's right.
So what? How did you manage that very, very rapid change, bringing in groups that are coders, groups that are, you know,
yeah.
they could, you know, they know the game space, all these different.
I sort of alluded that to that in my discussion, but let me be really blunt. We managed it incredibly poorly. Basically, what we did is we said, we have 20 people, we have a date. We have to hire people. So we went around Microsoft and did presentations on the future of Xbox and what we were doing. This wasn't recruiting, because that would have been considered a violation of Microsoft internal code. But of course, when you came and made the presentation, everybody wanted to come work for us. So we hired a ton of people from around Microsoft. And the problem with that is Microsoft is not Microsoft. The Windows team doesn't do their software development work with the same methodology that the Office team does. And we hired people from Windows and from Office and from the networking group and from a bunch of other parts of Microsoft, all of whom had a different approach to doing business and to writing code and to running a project. And then we hired, you know, probably out of 2,000, a couple of hundred from the games industry. And those people are crazy. And so you end up with this sort of United Nations team run by a weak leader from an undeveloped country called Robbie that really never came together as a team. And it wasn't until we stepped back and did the process of thinking through the strategy and the culture of the group and how we were going to run it as a leadership team that we got that cleared up. And in fact, when we made the shift from Xbox to Xbox 360, we lost a lot of people. And that was actually okay. There was addition by subtraction. With no offense to the people, they were skilled and good at what they did, but they didn't fit in the concept of what we wanted to do. And so there really was a sort of a cleansing period, and I don't mean that in like we didn't fire anybody, but people just naturally said, this is what I want to do. They left, they went, did something else, they found something else they wanted to do. We brought in other people and got the team formed. So, you know, lesson learned. You got to be really thoughtful when you're trying to build a team like that. Yeah, in the back.
So, yeah, those great framework you laid out. I'm curious how, you know, 2 decades ago, how you overcame the obstacle that Microsoft, you know, didn't have a track record or expertise in consumer hardware.
Yeah, it's a good question. There was always this debate about our credibility and whether Xbox could be and Microsoft could be a video game company. I mean, it was sort of, you know, you sort of asked the question, okay, these are the guys who do SQL Server and PowerPoint. How are they going to do video games? And in the end, that all became an exercise in sort of three things. One, on a marketing front, we went overboard to try to prove we were cool. You watch an early Xbox ad or an early Xbox marketing presentation, it's all about proving that we understand that the video game space is a wild and crazy space. There's explosions and there's shooting and there's all kinds of things that exaggerated what we were doing. You know, our slogan at the time was, no power greater than the power of X. I don't even know what that meant, but it had the word power in it, which we cared about. And it sounded somehow edgy and gamey. And so there's a marketing aspect to this that was really super important. It's also why they never let me do a demo. Because I wasn't a gamer. And so we always had this guy named Jay Allard or Ed Fries or somebody else who were serious gamers who had real credibility to do that kind of work. So that's the first thing. The second thing you do is you buy Bungie and produce Halo. Without Halo, Xbox dies and never survives. Not a chance in the world. And, you know, that was a crazy acquisition. We only paid $25 million for the company. That's probably made Microsoft, that franchise, probably a $4 or $5 billion franchise today. Incredible product. Looked really bad 4 or 5 months before we launched. By the time we launched, it was the best product in the market. And the final thing is we did this thing called Xbox Live, which suddenly people said, oh, these guys have new innovative ideas. You know, online social gaming on a video game console with voice. In a world in which broadband was just being created, I know that sounds weird today, but that's in fact true, was an innovative idea. And so you had to earn your cred. And the first version of Xbox was a $5 billion purchase of credibility. And the second version was the opportunity to reap the benefits of that that investment. Yeah.
Mm. Sure.
Yeah, I you know, if I was here representing the gaming industry, they would want me to talk about virtual reality and augmented reality and online social games and virtual worlds and simulations and all those types of things. So just assume that all of that exists. It's all real. I think augmented reality is probably more powerful than virtual reality, but that's just a personal opinion from a non-technical guy. Having almost thrown up playing a VR game, augmented reality felt a little more comfortable to me. But that's all happening. It's all real. And gaming is going to be a multi-platform thing. It's going to be phone. It's going to be still PC, very powerful PC business. Console still very relevant. So all of that is happening in the game space. The thing that I think is cooler is that all the technology and the money made from the technology, most of the money, most of the value, most of the future is actually not in gaming. All right. So if I'm doing virtual reality or augmented reality work today and I had to start a business, I wouldn't start it in gaming. That's going to be a giant cat fight in a mosh pit. I'd started in corporate training. I'd started in Salesforce automation. I'd started in medical technology and training. I would pick a series of places where people care about the experience, where they have to learn, and where it's expensive to learn. And be able to do that in a way that's more powerful. The simple example, the easiest one for me, I'm a sports guy. Stanford uses... virtual reality with their quarterbacks. And what it enables them to do is to have the coach virtually on the field with the quarterback seeing what the quarterback sees and be able to tell them what they're not seeing and what they should be seeing and what they should be doing. And you don't have to be out on the field doing that. You literally can be in the gym doing that. And so that's just the simplest sliver of where I see some of these things going. And there are... it's incredibly powerful. And again, to come back to my innovation thing, some of it's going to be about the experience. Part of the reason VR is struggling a little bit today is because the experience has some bumps. And so the question is going to be, can we get the experience right and the cost down so that people can do that for what they do in every day? It's the classic example of drones where you say, oh, it's cool, I can fly and look at my house. Well, nobody really cares about that. And it's not actually even military that people care about. Search and rescue. Think about that. Amazon and delivery. These are business applications of tools that were developed with other means in mind. But when somebody thinks about it, they say, oh my gosh, that's not even the biggest market. The biggest market's over here. You customize it for that, and you can make something really powerful. Yeah. Well, I think the thing that's hardest to learn as a young leader, as a new leader, and the thing I certainly failed at multiple times and somehow managed to survive, is you really have to figure out how to help people grow underneath you. And it turns out to actually be quite hard. Your tendency as a new leader is to want your team to like you and to be friends with them and to form a little cadre of people and do things. And in some ways, that's okay. But in fact, as a new leader, the harder thing to learn is to figure out how you can look at the three people that work for you and say, how do I help them be better? And what feedback do I give them? And how can I be really constructive and pointed to them and make them better? My first management job at Microsoft, I managed 8 people. And there were 2 or 3 people who were superstars. And frankly, they didn't need me. You know, they were, you know, I was a young leader. I barely knew what I was doing. They knew as what they were doing as well as I did. It was fine. And there were 2 or 3 people on that team who had good raw capabilities but needed work. And I didn't have the smarts or the chops or the guts to tell them that they needed work. And that was a huge disservice to them. And they didn't develop. And they ended up leaving the group. And so it's not so much about how you get attention, because I think that's a harder and different question. But if you want to really start learning about leadership, when you have that small team, it's the opportunity to experiment. It's the opportunity to give people real feedback. And it's the opportunity to suddenly build talent where the company didn't know it had talent. And suddenly somebody looks over at that team and says, oh, wow, they actually know what they're doing. They're all really good, and people start wanting to steal your talent. And that's when you know you've done your job, is when people come and say, I want to hire three people from that team. And then the rest of the company understands it as well. Last question.
Last question.
Go ahead. Well, I think I'll approach that quickly from two sides. One, you have to have the ability and willingness to persevere. I think the world of starting out in the business world or nonprofit world or wherever you decide to start, there's going to be some obstacles and hard knocks that come across your path. And you got to be willing to accept those and know that that's going to be the way it is for the rest of your life. Get used to it and figure out how to get over it and how to get past it. So that's the first piece of advice I'd give. The second piece of advice I'd give is you can still start to develop your leadership skills, even if you're not managing somebody. I don't accept that somebody who's a new hire can't be a leader. You can be a leader in the way you act and the things you do. You can be a leader on your team even if you're not the actual leader on your team. And by the way, you can be a leader in your community. And trust me, anybody who graduates from this school who wants to do something in the community is going to find organizations that want to take advantage of your skill. And so I think it starts right away. I don't think you wait. It's a different context. You're not managing 9,000 people. But the basic core skills and the basic things you want to do start right away. Thank you very much. I really enjoyed
it. All right. Thank you. Little gift for you.
Oh, thank you very much.
We're going to give another round of applause. I think that's one of the great talks we've had on leadership and strategy. Thank you so much, Robbie.
Thank you.
Terrific.
Enjoy.